Hello students, till the last lecture we have seen over the last lecture that the basic development of a feedback circuit using the positive feedback and from there leading to the concept of oscillators, and how with the help of the criteria called Barkhausen criteria, the basic explanation of the operation of the general oscillator can be framed or rather can be explained. And from there also we have seen the different types of oscillator based on the classification on different developments, on different criterias for the oscillators. And from there let us move on to discuss about the different types of oscillators now in a little bit details. So now we have the understanding of how a basic oscillator will work, will operate, and what are the conditions needed for sustained oscillation in the oscillator, and starting from the concept of feedback and negative feedback, and thereafter moving on to the regenerative or positive feedback, etc. And so let us start with the classification first, because we need the classification to get the names of those oscillators which will be discussed in details in this lecture. So let us first classify the oscillator in terms of frequency range of operation. I have already told you in the last lecture, one is audio frequency range of operation and another is radio frequency range of operation. That means AF oscillator and RF oscillators. And also another thing is based on the how the feedback network is formed, which is being used for the purpose of oscillation. And so based on that also we have seen that RC and LC are the different types of networks, different types of elements with which whose combinations can provide us the necessary feedback for the oscillators to work in under positive feedback. So now let us first start with this type of oscillator which is phase shift oscillator. So this is the first topic of discussion of this lecture, phase shift oscillator. And this is basically an RC oscillator which will work in the audio frequency range. So the specialty of phase shift oscillator is the feedback network of it comprised of R and C components, and it will work in the audio frequency range. So this oscillator will be called AF oscillator. Now let us first see an idealized version of this particular oscillator circuit, and then we will be moving on to the discussions and the derivations. So this is suppose a basic the basic amplifier of gain A, and the feedback network R and CCC we are considering for the time being that all values are equal for R and C. And so this network, which is comprised of this combinations of three sets of RNC combinations. So in this case, this is nothing but the feedback network. And this version of phase shift oscillator is idealized version. That means this, if this amplifier is selected in whatever type, this will be called the idealized version. This will be the at least the basic prototype of the circuit which is used for the phase shift operation, for oscillation. So this is our idealized version of circuit. Now, we may recall that the requirements for oscillation were from the last lecture, the loop gain, which is a beta, that should be greater than 1, or rather we can say the mod of a beta. If we consider that a beta, all these values are complex numbers, so we should be taking the mod of that. So mod of a beta should be greater than unity is one of the criteria for oscillation, and the phase shift around the feedback network is 180 degree, providing it is the positive feedback. Okay, this was as per the discussions we had regarding the Barkhausen criteria. But in the present idealization or idealized circuit, we are considering the feedback network to be driven by a perfect source, that means which is having zero source impedance, and the output of the feedback network to be connected into a perfect load which is having infinite load impedance. So zero source impedance is delivering power or signal to infinite load impedance, because this is considered as the idealized version of the circuit. Now this case will allow development of a particular theory behind the operation of the phase shift oscillator, and later on we will be discussing about the practical circuit versions replacing this idealized amplifier of having gain A with BJTs or FETs, or it may be replaced with op amps also. So let us first concentrate operation of this basic phase shift oscillator a little bit first, and then we will be move on to the special cases. So if we concentrate our attention on the phase shift network, we will be interested in the attenuation of the network at the frequency at which the phase shift is exactly 180 degree, because that is important. Otherwise, we cannot estimate how the output will come or will be shaped in front of us. So using the classical network analysis, if we use, we may find from this idealized version that frequency of operation of oscillation to be obtained from this version of phase shift oscillation is f equal to, denoted by f, this is frequency of operation or oscillation, we can also say this is 1 by 1 divided by 2 pi rc, where r and c are the values of this rc's, root over 6. So this is the general form of frequency, and also beta is 1 by 29. That means beta means the feedback gain or the feedback ratio or the feedback transmission factor, whatever you can say, that is equal to 1 by 29. And the phase shift is here introduced by this particular RC network, that is this particular network, which is being called here as feedback network. It is introducing the phase shift of 180 degree. So this is important. Now for the loop gain to be greater than unity, the gain of the amplifier stage must be greater than 1 by beta or 29. That means if we analyze this thing, for a beta, mod of a beta to be greater than 1, the gain of the amplifier stage, that means for a, it should be greater than 29. That means mod a beta greater than 1, a should be greater than 29, as we have seen that this is beta equal to 1 by 29. So if beta equal to 1 by 29 and a equal to greater than 29, that means a mod of a beta should be greater than 1 is satisfied. So this is another important development based on this idealized version of phase shift oscillator, for which this amplifier, which is being shown with gain a, should be having gain greater than 29 for oscillation to get out of it. Now, when considering the operation of the feedback network from this idealized circuit, we may select the values of R and C to provide us at a specific frequency 60 degree phase shift per section of the three. That means if we consider that at the frequency of oscillation or at the frequency of operation, this one set of RC combination will provide 60 degree phase shift. 60, this one 60 and this one 60. Now 360 degree means this 360 will combine to become 180 degree, which is written over here. So the overall phase shift network will be providing us 180 degree phase shift when each of the three RC combinations is providing us 60 degree phase shift, and because and accordingly the values of R and C should be chosen to design this feedback network. However, it is not the case that since each section of the RC in the feedback network loads down the previous one, that means there is no question of loading the next RC combination by the previous combination, and the net result is that the total phase shift be 180 degree. That is important, and so we can say there should not be any clash between the successive RC combinations for successfully providing us the 180 degree phase shift. And the frequency that is being written over here, this combination, this expression is that at which the total phase shift is 180 degree. If per section we measure the phase shift, each section would not provide the same phase shift, although the overall phase shift is 180 degree. So we can say it may be that each of the combinations is expected to provide us 60 degree phase shift, but in spite of that, in some cases it may be observed that each of these sections will not be providing the uniform phase shift. It may rather vary, but in spite of that, combining the three should be overall giving us the phase shift of 180 degree, and that is important to satisfy the criteria for oscillation. Now if it were to desired to obtain exactly 60 degree phase shift for each of the three stages of this RC combinations, then emitter follower stages would be needed for each RC section to prevent each from being loaded from the previous circuit. So if at all there is a question or there is a chance of loading by the next RC combination on the previous combination, so that the phase shift that is being delivered by each RC stage is being varied from 60 degree, then we may be using emitter follower stage between them, the RC sections, because what is the advantage of emitter follower? It gives us the exact voltage gain or the exact transparency of signal between its input and output, so that and also the matching of impedance between the two connecting stages with the help of that emitter follower circuit is very healthy, is very good. So therefore, if at all any loading problem is there between the successive RC stages, we should be preferring to use at least emitter follower stage. That should be added. So this is the basic preliminary discussion which can be explained for phase shift oscillator. So if we summarize the whole thing, we can say in this phase shift oscillator, external capacitor resistor network feeds a portion of the AC output of an amplifier. That means you can see that this external RC network, RC combination, and this is the output and this is the input of the amplifier. This RC combination is doing what? It is tapping the output from the amplifier and providing through it into its input. So it is tapping the output from here and providing through this feedback network into the input. So therefore, it is working as the feedback network. And if the amplifier has an internal phase shift in this process, if it is 180 degree. So this amplifier is giving us the, if it provides a phase shift of 180 degree between its input and output, we have seen for different amplifiers, especially in for BJT working in common emitter mode, there is a phase shift between input and output of 180 degree. If it happens to be so, and also the phase shift network, or rather feedback network, is further providing 180 degree phase shift in this process, 60-60-60 through each stage, the signal that is fed back to the input to the basic amplifier, which is this one, can be amplified to reproduce the output with an overall phase in this circuit as 360 degree, or rather it can be also called 0 degree. So the overall phase shift, overall phase shift is 360 or 0 degree. So this is important. So it will once again sounds like the Barkhausen criteria, and therefore we can say that the Barkhausen criteria is absolutely the two criteria. One is a mod of A beta greater than 1, and another is overall phase shift through throughout the circuit, going through the circuit is 360 degree or 0 degree is satisfied. Hence the circuit is very ideal, very suitable for the sustained oscillation. And it may generate its own input signal, and it will work without any input signal to be applied. One thing you can understand from this circuit, that there is no question of applying an external input signal, and it will work on generating its own input signal, and thereby a state of oscillation can be sustained from this circuit. Now let us move on to explain this operation in practical way. That means using replacing this A, amplifier A, with some specific amplifiers. So now let us see the circuit of phase shift oscillator using BJTs. Okay, so this is the basic circuit where a PNP transistor is being used. This is phase shift oscillator using PNP transistor, and that's why this is minus VCC, and R1, R2 is providing the voltage divider bias. REC are the resistance and capacitances with the emitter for AC bypassing case, and this is the combination. So this part is basically the amplifier with biasing part. This is the amplifier part which was in the idealized circuit providing us the gain A, and the rest part, the other part, this RC, RC and RC, these three combinations of stages, and along with this is the feedback part. That means this is the feedback network. Because at the output of the amplifier taken from the collector is passed through the feedback network to provide the beta gain as beta feedback feedback gain and or feedback ratio, whatever, or feedback factor, and that is fed back to the input of this BJT at its base. You can see, so taken from output, went through the feedback network to get the gain as beta, and fed back to the input through base or at base of the BJT. So this is the phase shift oscillator circuit using BJT. Now here, if the resistances R1, R2, RL and RE and the oscillator power supply VCC serve the required DC biasing to get the operating point or the Q point of the transistor in the active region of characteristics, and CE is obviously the emitter bypass capacitor. So R1, R2 minus VCC, REC, these will be combinedly doing the fixation of Q point or the DC operating condition for this BJT to work in active region, so that it can work as an amplifier. And this particularly CE, you know, it works for AC bypassing. So the transistor is operating here in common emitter mode and produces a phase shift of, since it is working in common emitter mode, here CE mode is the mode of operation, and you know from the concepts of BJT that CE mode will be providing us 180 degree phase shift between input and output voltages. So here, whatever is the phase, here at the output it is 180 degree out of phase with this one. If this is V in and this is V out, then V out and V in should be in 180 degree out of phase or deferred phase. So an additional 180 degree phase shift is required, and that is produced by this three combinations of RC circuits, and the three sections are made identical here. You can also note that, and note one thing also here, that the last stage, which is having this the resistance denoted by R prime, that is equal to R minus HIE, and this value is important. This is something different from the this R's, and this is because this resistor is connected with the base of the transistor. The input resistance of the transistor is HIE, because from this last, you can see from this circuit, from this last resistance R prime, it is connected to the base of this BJT, and you know from the H parameter equivalent circuit of BJT, the input resistance of BJT is denoted by HIE. So that means, in other words, in some way, this R value of this feedback network or the resistor R is somehow mixed up with or combined with the input resistance of BJT, which is HIE, and thereby its value is changed from R to R prime, and R prime is obtained as R minus HIE. So this R prime is the difference of this original value R minus this input resistance of BJT, and because this R is directly connected to the input resistance of BJT. So we can say the input resistance of the transistor HIE is added to it to give a total resistance of R. That means it is somehow written as R dash is equal to R plus minus HIE. So this is added in such a way, this minus is because of the negative feedback, because it is this is for positive feedback for oscillation, and this minus HIE is because it is so connected with this R which was the previous value of this particular resistance, that the overall resistance is getting down from the previous value R, so that it can be newly named as R prime. And this overall circuit will be providing the positive feedback into the base from the output of the BJT amplifier. And so the connection between this last resistance and the input resistance HIE of the BJT is such a way done, the polarities are such a way selected of the voltages and currents, that this minus should be coming and they should be added. So this should be the equivalent resistance of this because of this connection. So HIE, the input resistance of the transistor HIE is added to it in such a way to give a total resistance of R. So the RC phase shift networks serve as the frequency determining circuit here, you can see. And since only at a single frequency the net phase shift around the loop will be 0 degree or 360 degree, as I have told you, because here it is Vin versus Vout is 180 degree between these two, and as a whole these three combinations will be providing another 180 degree phase shift. So as a result, the whole oscillator circuit will be providing 360 degree or 0 degree total phase shift. So it is matching the Barkhausen criteria. So now, because of this, a sinusoidal waveform at this frequency, at which this oscillator is working, will be generated. Phase shift oscillators, as I have told you, commonly used for audio frequency ranges. Now here, one important thing I need to discuss is that the output of the feedback network is loaded appreciably because of use of this transistor or BJT as the active element in the amplifier stage. And because of that, the output of the feedback network is loaded appreciably by the relatively low input resistance of, because for BJT, you know that the input resistance HIE is generally very low. So this relatively low input resistance of the transistor will load appreciably the feedback network. That means the feedback network is directly connected to this input of the BJT via this resistance HIE, and which is appreciably low, and because of that the feedback network will be driven very high. So that will be, there will be a loading effect on the feedback network because of this low resistance of HIE. And therefore, I have already told you just a little while earlier that an emitter follower input stage followed by this common emitter amplifier stage should be used in that case. So between this feedback network and this inputs of this C-mode BJT, a voltage follower circuit may be used for proper impedance matching, and it also provides unity gain. So there will be transparency of the propagation of the signal between the feedback network and the input of the C-mode amplifier stage. Now, if a single transistor stage is desired, however, the use of the voltage shunt feedback can be more suitable topology for this case. And in this connection, the feedback signal will be coupled through the feedback resistor R dashed in series with the amplifier stage input resistance RI. So in this case, since it is voltage series feedback configuration is used, but if we want to use the voltage shunt feedback configuration, so there will be a little bit change to be made in the feedback network, and the feedback signal in that case should be coupled through the feedback resistor R prime. This R prime, this should be then connected in series with the amplifier stage input resistance RI. That should be connected. The amplifier stage input resistance RI is this is having the resistance look like this from here. So if that is my RI or RIN, and with that this R dash is connect, it should be connected in such a way that they may be connected in series for voltage shunt feedback topology. Now let us move on to find the analysis and the derivation of frequency for transistor phase shift oscillator using this circuit diagram. Here the biasing resistances R1, R2 have no effect on the AC operation of the circuit since they are large, and hence the equivalent circuit of the phase shift oscillator can be drawn first. So let us see how the equivalent circuit will look like, because R1, R2 will not be affecting the AC operation, and hence they are omitted from this AC equivalent circuit. So this is the AC equivalent circuit, for the above circuit. You can see that R1 and R2 are omitted in this AC equivalent circuit, as they will be having no effect in this. At the input side, the input resistance HIE is being shown, and the using the H parameter, and I2 is the current that is flowing from the feedback network into the input of the circuit, input of the amplifier. HREV2 is the dependent voltage source, the for the reverse voltage, you know, from the H parameter operation, and HFEI3 is the forward transfer current gain, and this is a current source, this is a voltage source, dependent voltage source and dependent current source, like this. So this portion is the representation of BJT itself working in as amplifier. Sorry, it should be included this resistance also. So this four HIE, this resistance in the shunt, 1/HOE, this current source and this voltage source, this dependent sources, as a whole, this whole thing is the representation of BJT as amplifier here. And the other things at the input, no other resistances should be taken into account because of AC operation, because R1, R2 are responsible only for DC analysis, and VCC will not be there. It should be connected to, shorted to ground, because it is a DC voltage, this minus VCC. And the other things is CCC, this C, all C's are there, and the load resistance RL is also shown, and this R values are also shown in this fashion. So this is nothing but the AC equivalent circuit of the phase shift oscillator, and since RE and CE are also being used for the DC biasing condition determination, so they are also omitted in this particular circuit representation. So now if we compare this 1 by HOE resistance, that is much larger than RL. So if we compare these two resistances, 1 by HOE, that is the output impedance or output resistance we can say, is much more greater than this load resistance. So as a result of that, its effect of load resistance RL can be neglected in this AC equivalent circuit. And also, since HRE of the transistor is usually very small, this HRE V2, HRE is very small in this circuit, the reverse voltage gain, you know, that so this term HRE V2 will also be neglected in that case. So the equivalent circuit model, this representation will therefore be reduced further, where the current source has been replaced by its equivalent voltage source. So we can say, and this current source is replaced by the equivalent voltage source using source transformation. How it can be done? This current source parallel with this resistance should come in the series, and this current source will be converted to voltage source. So the modified AC equivalent circuit will be something like this. This is RL, C, 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 and the three resistances are this is the voltage source. This should be obviously dependent source. It should be drawn as dependent source. So this voltage source is having, this side is plus, this side is minus. Because of feedback, the polarities are changed. This is HFE I3 RL, HFE I3 RL. So current into resistance, that means this is the voltage, and in series with this RL, and here it is C, 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 and this is R, R, and R. I1 is going into this, I2 is going into this, and I3 is going into this. So this is the modified form of equivalent circuit. What we have done over here, since 1 by HOE is far greater than RL, so in this equivalent circuit, we have neglected this 1 by HOE, the very high value, because it will be treated as an open circuit. So that means this resistance will not be there, only RL will be there, and RL parallel with this current source is converted into voltage source in series with voltage source in series with the resistance RL. And this current source is having value HFE I3 multiplied by RL is giving us the voltage, and that is the equivalent voltage source which is shown over here in with a series resistance RL. So this is the portion which is replaced over here, modified like this, and all these RC combinations are shown over here. This is obviously neglected because of very small value of HRE, and HIE is not represented here because HIE is already included to find this last resistance R, because last resistance in this three RC combination, the last one is combined with this HIE to get the new value of R. So R prime is combined with this HIE to get the new value of R, and this R within this RC, the HIE value is included. So within this R, HIE is included. So that's why so for the first loop 1, having current I1, it is RL plus R minus JXC. XC is the reactance of the capacitance. I1 minus R I2 plus HFE RL I3 is equal to 0. So this is the voltage source, this is the drop across resistance R with the value of I2, and this is the total impedance through which the current I1 is flowing. So this is equation number 1. For loop 2, we can write minus R I1 plus 2R minus JXC I2 minus JXC I2 minus R I3 is equal to 0. And for the third loop, we may write 0 into I1, because there is no 0 actually, no I1 in that loop, minus R I2 plus 2R minus JXC I3 is equal to 0. Now we have three equations, and here we can say the XC is given by 1 by omega C. This is the reactance of the capacitors, those are used for forming the feedback network. Now here you can see the as the currents I1, I2, I3 are not vanishing, that means they should represent the different loop currents. So I1, I2, I3 are having I1 not equal to 0, I2 not equal to 0, and I3 not equal to 0. Since this is so, with the help of these three equations, we can form the determinant for the coefficients I1, I2, I3, because they are having non-zero values, using these three equations, and that determinant must be 0. So we can say, taking out the coefficients from these three equations, we can form the determinant from the first equation, coefficients of I1, I2 and I3. For the first equation, it is RL plus R minus JXC, then it is minus R, and then it is HFE RL. Then for the second equation, it is minus R, 2R minus JXC minus R. And for the third equation, first coefficient is 0, then it is minus R, and then it is 2R minus JXC. Now obviously, this determinant must be 0 to satisfy these equations, because I1, I2, I3 are non-zero. So the coefficient, the determinant that is formed with the help of the coefficients of I1, I2, I3, that must be equal to 0. So if we solve this determinant, we may write RL plus R minus JXC, RL, take the first term, RL plus R minus JXC into 3R square minus J4 R J4 RXC minus XC square minus R square 2R minus JXC plus HFE RL R square equal to 0. So just resolving this determinant, we can find this equation. We can write this equation like this. Now if we put this the imaginary part of this equation to 0, because we will be putting separately its imaginary part and then its real part into 0. So we can write from here minus RL plus R whole into 4R XC minus XC into 3R square minus XC square plus XC R square equal to 0. Or this is putting imaginary part equal to 0 for equation number 4, if this is called the equation number 4. For equation 4, so this can be written as minus 4 by simplification R RL minus 6 R square plus X square is equal to 0. So therefore X square is equal to minus 4 R RL, sorry, 4 R RL plus 6 R square. So now put X square is equal to 1 by omega square C square, that is 4 R RL plus 6 R square. So therefore omega square is equal to 1 by C square into 4 R RL plus 6 R square. And therefore what is f frequency? It is omega by 2 pi, that is equal to 1 by 2 pi c root over 4 r rl plus 6 r square. So this is the expression for frequency of oscillation in case of RC phase shift oscillator using BJT. So this f is nothing but frequency of oscillation. Now let us equate the real part of equation number 4 to 0. So real part by real part of equation 4 equal to 0. If we do that, then we may get RL plus R into 3R square minus X square. To do this, first this equation 4 should be written in such a way that we should be separating its real part and imaginary part. Take J common from the J terms to separate the imaginary part, and the rest of the part will be the real part. This you can do. So 3R square minus X square bracket closed minus 4R X square minus 2R cube plus HFE RL R square equal to 0, or we may write HFE RL R square is equal to 23 R square RL plus 29 R cube plus 4 R RL square. So therefore we can find HFE from here as 23 plus 29 R by RL plus 4 RL by R. So this is the condition for sustained oscillation. That means this must be the gain of the transistor that is being used in the circuit to get this condition for sustained oscillation. Now in practice, usually R is generally taken, RL as generally taken equal to R. This is usually in practice for simplification of purpose of design we should generally take. So the equation which we have found for the expression for free